Good morning, everybody. Today we will study about engine geology, and in that we will study the sedimentary rocks. So what are the sedimentary rocks? These are the loose unconsolidated accumulations of mineral rocks particles that have been transported by wind, water, ice or gravity and redeposited layer by layer into big stratas ranging from millimeters to the meters. These are derived from the Latin sedimentum term, which means settling. This refers to a solid material settling out of a fluid. So how do they are formed? They are formed by weathering of pre-existing rocks, or either by physical breakup into finer fragments, or by solution precipitation of crystal out of solutions. Usually the particles are broken down further during this transport phase, and after breaking they will be converted into sediments, small sediments, and that sediments become lithified or turn into the different stratas of the earth. Or these all the rocks which are converted into sediments will be converted into will be deposited layer by layer, and this will be converted into the strata, and these strata will be named as sedimentary rocks. So what is clastic sedimentary rock? This form the Greek word klatos. This clastic word comes from the Greek word klatos, meaning broken, formed from the product of the mechanical breakup of other rocks. So the formation of clastic sedimentary rocks is from the breakup of other rocks. Broken up into these big rocks and are broken up into smaller and smaller pieces, and ultimately into an individual mineral. Okay. So when you strike this hammer on this rock, it will disintegrate into small pieces of the rock, because this is made up of the addition of the different sediments, of big and small sediments of the different rocks. So what is the economic importance of the sedimentary rocks? Presently the source of over half the electronic power in the United States. So presently sedimentary rocks are the source of the half of the electronic power in the United States. Presently the source of over half the electronic power in the United States. Other major energy sources like petroleum and natural gas occur in the pores of the sedimentary rocks. So in the United States, the source of half of the electronic power is sedimentary rock, and in those sedimentary rock pores there are deposits of petroleum and natural gas. So in the United States, the deposits of the petroleum and natural gas occur in the sedimentary rocks pores. Other sedimentary rocks are major sources of iron, aluminium, manganese, fertilizer and sand and gravels. These are the pictures of few sedimentary rocks which are deposited over the years, and these are the different forms, and these are deposited in different circumstances in the environment and taken the actual shape after millions of years of time. So the classification of sedimentary rocks are detrital sedimentary rocks, These are the solid particles from weathered rocks such as igneous rocks. These rocks are also called conglomerate if the sediment is rounded. If the sediment is rounded, these rocks are called conglomerate. So conglomerate word refers to the rounded aggregate adhesive have joined together or have adhesive together. This rock is called breccia if the pieces are angular. So if these rocks pieces are in angular, then they are called breccia. Other forms are sandstone. This sandstone name given to the rock when sand grains prevail. So if in a rock there are more amount of sand grains, then that rock is named as sandstone. Shale is made of very fine grained sediments. So if there are, if a rock contains fine grained sediments or made up of fine grained sediments, that particular rock will be named as shale. Siltstone is sometimes difficult to differentiate from such rocks such as shale, which is composed of even smaller clay sized sediment. So if a rock is composed of small sized sediments, very small sized sediment, then that particular rock will be named as siltstone. Coquina, a coarse rock composed of loosely cemented shells and shell fragments. So coquina is a kind of coarse rock which composed of loosely cemented shell and shell fragment like this. It is mainly available, it's mainly found in seashores area where these different fragments of shells join together and form the coquina rock. Chalk, another form of sedimentary rock, chalk, soft porous rock made up almost entirely of the hard parts of the microscopic organism. So if the stone which is made up of soft porous rock made up of almost entirely of the hard parts of the microscopic organism, so this name as chalk. Now next is coal. The coal is quite different from other chemical sedimentary rocks. The end product of the burial of large amounts of the plant material over the extended period. So coal is also named as fossils. They are found from the fossils, from the remains of the animals and plants buried under the earth millions of years ago. So we divide sedimentary rocks into the two major groups, detrital and chemical. The main criteria for classifying rocks are distinguished by their mineral composition. So the main criteria of classifying the rocks is their mineral composition. Now what is lithification of sediment? It refers to the process of by which the sediments are transformed into solid sedimentary rocks. Cementation. What is cementation? Another important means by which sediments are converted to the sedimentary rock. Now, what are the features of sedimentary rock? Sedimentary rocks are particularly important evidence of Earth's long history, strata. The single most characteristic feature of the sedimentary rock is strata, because it is formed layer by layer, one over the other. That's why they are converted into strata and they are named as strata. So that sedimentary rock deposits are in strata form. That's why they are the most important characteristic to define a sedimentary rock formation. Sedimentary rocks provide geologists with evidence deciphering past environment. So it reveals the type of environment which was there present in the millions of years ago by deciphering it. will deal with metamorphic rocks. Produced from pre-existing igneous sedimentary or from other metamorphic rocks, these rocks are produced from the pre-existing igneous or sedimentary rocks. These are derived from the these two basic types of rock, igneous and sedimentary. It is generally found beneath the earth's surface, almost more up to the range of almost 7 kilometers below the earth's surface. And every metamorphic rock has a parent rock, the rock from which it was formed. What does metamorphism mean? Metamorphism is to change form that take place where existing rock is subjected to the temperatures unlike those in which it is formed. So when it is, as I said, that it is formed below, almost in the range of 7 kilometers below the earth crust. So in that there will be high temperature, and that high temperature will force the sediments or the minerals present in that to fuse together and form a new crystal form, and that form will represent the new mineral of that particular rock. And that change of fusion from two different mineral to one mineral is known as metamorphism. Most changes occur at the elevated temperature and pressures that exist in the zone beginning a few kilometers below Earth's surface and extending into the upper mantle. So most metamorphism occurs in two things: thermal metamorphism and regional metamorphism. In thermal metamorphism, when intruded by a magma body, change is driven by rise in temperature within the host rock surrounding a molten igneous body. So when there is a surrounding molten igneous body, that the change is driven by the rise in temperature. So as we all know, that molten igneous body will have a high temperature, and that high temperature is in the order of the that it can fuse or it can melt the crystal. So that the mineral crystal in that particular rock will melt and fuse together with the surrounding the mineral of the surrounding rock, and then form a new mineral. That mineral will be of the new rock, which named as metamorphic rock. Now, in the regional metamorphism, during mountain building, great quantities of rock are subjected to direct pressures and high temperatures and associated with the large scale deformation. So in regional metamorphism, during the mountain formation, they are subjected to large pressure and high temperatures, and that associated with the large scale deformation. Now, next is agents of metamorphism. So, the agents which drive the metamorphism. First is heat. Heat is the most important agent of metamorphism. It provides energy to drive chemical reactions that result in recrystallization of existing minerals and or the formation of the new minerals. So as the temperature rises, the heat in that the heat around the rock will trigger the chemical reaction, and that chemical reaction will result in the recrystallization of the existing mineral and formation of the new mineral. So the two sources of heat are: rock experience a rise in temperature when they are intruded by the magma rising from below or contact metamorphism. So once that the rock, the subject rock which is in contact with the molten magma, or it comes in contact with the molten magma, in that form the rise in temperature will induce the intruding effect. And that intruding effect will change the it morphs the sediments, the subject rock sediments, into the fusion of that crystal of the particular subject rock, and again forms into a another crystal or mineral. And that we name this metamorphic rock. Second, the rocks that form at Earth's surface experience a gradual increase in temperature as they are transported to greater depths. Stress as a metamorphic content. Like temperature also increases with the depth as the thickness of the overlying rock increases. So temperature increases as we go deep below the earth's surface. The deeper you go in the ocean, the greater you can find pressure. The other rock that is buoyant. So if you go depth in the ocean, the more pressure will be on the per centimeter square of subject, and then the high pressure will be an agent which triggers or which helps in metamorphosis. So the differential stress forces that generate mountains are unequal in different directions. Differential stress act mainly as along the plane. So if this is the plane, the differential stress will act along the plane. So it will act along the plane. Now, chemically active fluids. The chemically active fluids composed mainly of water and other volatiles, believed to play an important role in some types of metamorphism. Hot fluids and in the recrystallization of the mineral grains by dissolving material from regions of high stress, then precipitating this region to regions of low stress. So these chemically active fluids such as water and volatiles will play as chemical active fluids which will help or which will play as an agent in metamorphism. So the metamorphic textures rocks need forms when shale is subjected to temperatures and pressures only slightly greater than those associated with the compaction that lithifies the sediment. So if that happens, then this kind of structure will be formed from the shale. So if we have types of metamorphic rocks, major types are foliated rocks. The reorientation of the mineral grains into layered or banded appearance. So if there is a reorientation of mineral grains into the layer or banded appearance, then we can say that it is a foliated rock. Slate is a very fine grained foliated rock composed of minute flakes. So that slate is a very fine grained foliated rock which are composed of minute flakes. A most useful rock for roof and floor tile, chalkboards and billiard tables. So slate is a very useful rock for roof and floor, chalkboards and the billiard tables. Can be almost of any color. It can be of almost of any color depending on its mineral constitution. So depending on mineral constitution, it can be of any color. Black slate contains organic material. So if the slate is in black color, so it contains the organic materials. Next is schist, strongly foliated rocks formed by regional metamorphism. So this is an example of regional metamorphism named schist. Platy and can be readily split into thin flakes or slab. So it can be if it subjected to high pressure or some force, it can be split into thin flakes or thin slabs. So if we come to the non-foliated rocks, marble is a good example of non-foliated rocks, a coarse crystalline rock whose parent rock is limestone. This composed of large interlocking calcite crystals which form from crystallization of smaller grains in the parent rock. So these are few examples of the marble, different kinds of marble with different color. Now we will discuss about the structural features of the rock named fold, fault, joint. Today we will discuss about faults and faults. So faults are formed due to ductile deformation, compressive stress and horizontal rocks are deformed. So these faults are the product of ductile deformation, compressional stress and the horizontal rocks are deformed. In this case, horizontal rocks are deformed in such manner. So, in fold, these are named as limbs. This is axis of plane along which the fold is symmetrically symmetrical or divided into two parts, two equal parts. Now, there is one more thing, fold axis or hinge line. So, at this point, the center from where the axis plane pass will be a hinge point, and at that point, the hinge line will be into the in the third direction, like in a plane, will be in the third inside direction, and that width will be called as the hinge line, like we see here. This is the hinge line. This is the limb. This is the axial plane through which it is divided into two. So, types of fold. The two major types of folds are synclined and anticlined. In synclined, folds will have the convex downward shape, and the younger strata will be near to the center, and the older strata will be on the outer layer of the synclined. Whereas in anticlined, it will be just opposite. The older strata will be near to the center, and the younger data will be on the upper crust of the upper layer of the fold. So it is generally convex upward. So it is only convex upward. So this is alternate synclined and anticlined. What is monocline? Monocline is that when it just bends on from the axis of plane on one side only, and other side it remains flat. So it is monocline, or it has one limb only. Other types of folds are symmetrical fold and asymmetrical. Symmetrical means it is divided in two equal parts from the axis of plane, and if it doesn't, then it will be a asymmetrical fold. So overturned flow. Overturned flow would be when one of the limb is folding on the other limb, like in this. It is folding on the other limb. That's why it is named as overturned fold. These are a few examples of overturned fold. Now, the plunging fold. So, what is plunging? Plunging is the angle it will make with the horizontal plane or the axis of plane in horizontal direction. So, if the fold is having some angle with respect to the horizontal, then it will be named as plunged angle, and if it tilted about that angle, then that fold will be named as plunging fold. Few examples of plunging fold. Now we came to fault. Why would we study about fault? It is the most unfavorable and undesirable. Faults will weaken the rocks For example, the case histories of St. Francis Dam will give an idea of important study of the fault. It is due to brittle deformation. It is due to the brittle deformation. So what is fault? It is nothing but the fractures in the earth crust where displacement has occurred. Now, fault terminology. So we will see the fault now. So this is the fault plane. This is the hanging wall. This is the footwall. This is the head in this direction. And this is fault scarp. Or fault scarp. Now, what is heap? Heap will be this, the upper part. Now, classification of faults. It is done according to the following condition: type of displacement along the fault plane, relative movement of footwall and hanging wall, types of slip involved, and mutual relations of attitudes of the fault plane and the adjacent beds. I'll show you to the here. Now, the first classification of displacement along fault plane is transitional fault and rotational fault. So, if we are telling about the transitional fault, that fault, transitional fault is here. The hanging wall will be going down and footwall will be going up. In rotational fault, we have two different types of fault, hinge fault and scissors fault. In hinge fault, along the plane and along the plane of the fault, it will be going at some angular direction or some angle. In scissors fault, it will be going very less, means one is at the point and another will be along the plane of the angle. Next is normal fault, or gravity fault, and reverse fault. If the hanging wall is in the downward direction and footwall in the upper direction, it will be on a normal fault, and the hanging wall will be in the upper direction and footwall in the lower direction, it will be named as reverse fault. Next is strike slip fault, dip slip fault, and oblique slip fault. So, if there is any more strike slip fault, it will be striking against the two different faces. It will be striking on the lateral direction. So, it will be striking like this. Now, classification according to mutual relations of attributes of the fault plane and adjacent bed. So, strike fault, dip fault, and bedding fault are three different types of classification under the mutual relations of the attributes of the fault plane and adjacent plane, which you can see in this diagram. Next is the classification of the mode of occurrence. One is radial fault, and one is acute fault, and other is anechoic fault. So these are the three basic classifications under the mode of occurrence of the faults. The other type of fault are step faults and parallel faults. There are some horrid and graben fault also, which you can see here on the figure. So this is all about the fault. In next class we will study more about the joints. Thank you.